nice to be here. I hope you're all enjoying your visit. Today, I'm going to talk to you about the area of research that I, in particular, am passionate about, and that is in finding out more about how to have our cells be ways that we can actually treat diseases. And so what I'm going to talk about are adult stem cells. So we exist because of cells. That's what make up our bodies. We're made up of the structures that you see here. There are fundamental building blocks, and without cells, we would not exist. But cells are the building blocks, not just of us, but of all kinds of animals on the planet, from plants to a number of the animals that you see here. Now, the problem with, or first I'll start off by saying that cells themselves are incredibly diverse. So although I showed you a picture where all the cells look alike, that's actually not the case in our bodies. Our cells are incredibly diverse, and you're just seeing a couple of examples on this slide. We actually have several hundred different kinds of cells that make up our bodies. And these cells have different properties. Some are really strong, some are flexible, some can actually move and change their shape and contract. And those are some of the examples you see up here, from muscle to blood to bone. And these cells have very important functions, right? They have these different properties and they're going to do different things in our bodies. But the problem with being made out of cells is that cells themselves are destructible. They're not all powerful things that always exist in our bodies. They actually can be damaged, they can malfunction, they can have diseases affect them. And so we're made out of cells, and that's a wonderful thing, but this is actually a fundamental problem that medicine faces that we have to try to grapple with. And so what medicine fundamentally is about is trying to deal with healing cells, making more of them, and actually trying to understand how cells go awry in terms of their function and how the cells actually become abnormal and die. So the big challenge that's facing medicine today and will continue to face medicine is how to fix cells in our body when they're broken. How do we replace them if they are not just broken, but they die and they go away? And so how do we do that? How do we know enough about cells to actually make more of them or to fix them? And this is where stem cell research comes in. So the organ that I'm particularly interested in that my lab studies is the kidney. And this is an organ made up of a lot of different cell types, anywhere between 20 and 30 different cell types, depending on the critter that we're talking about. Here you're seeing a human kidney, a simple diagram, and it's actually made out of a series of tubes that will clean the blood and actually make a urine product. And I'm just showing you blow-ups of shapes of a couple of the different types of cells in the kidney in a cartoon form. And they're, again, incredibly diverse. Even within one organ, they're quite different. And they each do different jobs. It's not just me drawing different, you know, shapes and sizes and colors. They're actually meant to represent that the fact that the cells themselves are all very different. And so the challenge in dealing with an organ like this is you have so many diverse cells. And if certain ones break down, what happens? Well, in our kidneys, when we have cells die or become abnormal, for the most part, there's no option to replace them. Our bodies have a very limited ability to fix and heal these cells. And so the thing that we want to be able to do is figure out, how do you make more cells? How could you actually regenerate these? So then the question becomes, well, where do cells come from, right? We're made of cells, they're diverse, they can be damaged and be destroyed. Well, where do they actually come from? The answer is that cells come from other cells. That's where they come from. So that's the big question. So then we need to know, well, how does that work, right? That's the simple answer, but how does that actually happen? Well, we actually, believe it or not, we start from one single cell. So every single person in this room, we started out as one cell. And that cell had the ability to make every single part of you. It had the ability to make all the different cell types in your body. And the cell that I'm pointing here with the arrow is that first cell. So that cell is all powerful. It can make every cell type in the body. Now, this is a phenomenon of development where you craft from that one cell, many more cells will be made, that cell will replicate itself, and then give rise to all kinds of tissues and organs. And this is not a phenomenon, however, that's unique to development. So although we're made from one cell, as was mentioned earlier by Dean Crawford, all of us have a number of different cell types in our body that can continue to do the task of making other cells. And these cells are called adult stem cells. So they reside in different places in the body, as diverse from the brain to organs that will produce blood. So this would be bone, which you're seeing here at the bottom. Bone is the place where hematopoietic cells are living and are produced regularly. And other areas of the body are very contentious still. Are there stem cells there or not? Are there stem cells in the kidney? Are there stem cells in the heart? These are actually areas that people are really actively investigating. The ability to keep making new cells in adulthood is, compared to the embryo, relatively restricted. So these cells scattered throughout our body, they're only going to make certain types. Cells making blood will make blood. Cells making neurons in the brain will make neurons in the brain. And so they are restricted in their abilities, and they do tend to be rare. Now, the bottom line, what I'm telling you, is that stem cells, this property of a cell to make more cells, is something that's a feature of development, and we still have some feature of this in our adult body, by which we have cells that can make more of themselves and make lots of different offsprings. And so that's what our lab is actually trying to understand. How do cells do these phenomena? How do they actually make these decisions? How do you be stem-like? So if we're going to try to use stem cells for the treatment of medical conditions, the question really is, which cells? Are there cells in our body that could actually be harnessed to make more cells in a way that won't cause more harm than good? So which cells do we use? Where do they come from? And how are we going to actually do this? And that's the real big challenge right now in the field, is understanding how to answer this question. As I said, in the early embryo, the first cells can make all the cell types in the body. And so for many decades now, it's been known that in certain embryos, you can actually take the early cells and grow them in a dish. And they keep this amazing ability to make all the cell types. And so what you're seeing here is cells grown in a dish that maintain their immortality and their pluripotency. And these are called embryonic stem cells because they came from the embryo. And as you can see here, people want to be able to take advantage of this, to use these stem cells to make lots of different cell types, anything from the pancreas to the kidney cell, or other ones you see here, like blood and neurons. But there are a number of problems with working with these cells. So first, you had to use an embryo to start with. So an embryo, a life, was actually taken away. The other our next big challenge is in actually going from the ES culture to the cell type. That's a long road to go. So how do you do that in a controlled way? How do you make sure that you make the right cell type? It's a many-step process, or many steps are involved in that process. It's not a simple 1 + 2 = 3. And so this is a huge challenge. The other large challenge that I'll bring up is that we can't just grow cells and give them to people. They might not be compatible. So you need cells that your body won't recognize as foreign and go and try to destroy. So for all these reasons, it's a really complicated problem to use cells that came from an early embryo. So one alternative that has been discovered relatively recently is something known as reprogramming. And to set the stage for this, I'm going to tell you that although we're made of cells that are very stable, our kidneys themselves are quite stable, they're not going to normally go and have cells decide, well, I'm going to change what I am, I'm going to become a different cell type. That doesn't just happen normally. If it does happen, it's a disease called cancer, right? And the cells shouldn't be changing their behavior and becoming something else. So when a cell has a particular fate associated with it, and it's differentiated, and it does a certain task, this is a stable condition. The discovery that was made relatively recently is that although this is very stable, it's not permanent. So with the right instructions, with the right triggers, cells can actually change their behavior and become more stem-like, act like a cell that can actually make many different cell types. So it's not irreversible to go along the path of becoming a neuron or becoming a cell in our skin. And so this This discovery is known as reprogramming, by which researchers have found that particular instructions, here you're seeing that there's a combination of four factors coming in and tinkering with the cell that's in the lower left-hand corner of the screen, and telling that cell, based on those bits of information, to change its behavior from being a cell in the skin to a cell that can make any cell type in the body, which is utterly phenomenal, to become skin, or to be skin, and then to be able to be anything, kidney to blood to a heart cell. And so this ability to induce cells to change what they are is something crucial to being able to make progress in the use of cells for medicine. And so what I've told you so far is that we need to find cells that have the ability to make other cells, and we could use these, if we can find them, potentially for lots of applications in medicine. And cells that already exist in our bodies that we know can replenish certain tissues or adult stem cells, as well as the ability to tell cells with the right instructions to act like that or to be reprogrammed, these are two major ways that we can advance the field. So then the question becomes, what signal, right? If it all hinges on the instructions, what the heck is the recipe, right? What's actually going to tell the cell in the right way how to change its behavior, how to go and rejuvenate a tissue and replenish something that might be broken or abnormal in that tissue? And so what my lab is doing is trying to uncover that recipe in a particular cell for a particular group of cells in the body, for the kidney, actually. And that recipe can be gleaned by observing how other animals do tasks like regeneration. So lots of animals can actually regenerate tissues. As we can regularly regenerate our blood, they can regenerate things like the kidney that we intrinsically can't do. And the zebrafish, not the zebra mussel, is a fish that is very adept at being able to replace different cell types in its body, including its kidney. And so what you're seeing here is a picture, or drawing of a fish rather, and they have kidneys ultimately that have long plumbing tubes, just like we do, that have lots of different cell types, and so that's the color cartoon you're seeing. And so it's very similar in structure actually to our kidneys, although we're walking around on land and they're swimming around in a tank of water. And when cells in the fish are damaged, there will be massive destruction of cells, and the cells will actually be excreted into the urine. And this is what happens in people too when there's massive damage to the kidney that becomes irreparable. But the fish, unlike us, so a day after a traumatic injury where you see gaps in the tissue, so the white spaces in the picture at the bottom are where cells have been destroyed, and the cells that are being destroyed are, as I said, they're being flushed out the tubes of plumbing, and so those are the big pink blotches that you're seeing there. As quickly as 1 week after damage, we found that the fish can actually restore integrity to the kidney. So that those plumbing tubes that make up the kidney are re-inhabited by normal functioning cells that can continue to clean the work, now can work to continue to clean the blood. And fish can also do something else, which is rather fascinating. And that is depicted in the actual picture of cells at the bottom by the darker purple cells. And in the cartoon, you see these dark purple squigglies, extra tubes that are actually plumbing into the existing tubes. So fish not only regenerate the cells in the tubes themselves, but they actually make entirely new tubes. So they have two major phenomena that they can do in order to counteract kidney damage. And by another week later, all of those tubes are functional. So the fish can respond to a really acute kidney injury that for most people would mean that they'd have to be on dialysis the rest of their life and ultimately undergo a kidney transplant to have proper renal function. In 2 weeks, a fish can basically say, well, no problem, I can deal with that. I just made myself a new kidney. And so we are trying to understand what those signals are that the fish use to figure out there's damage and now let's make a new cell. And what are those signals, and can we actually apply them to people? And in the long run, these types of approaches can be used directly for a disease like kidney disease, but with regard to other organs, other researchers at our university and others are applying these types of similar questions in terms of how do animals make new cell types when there's damage, and apply that to understanding and treating other types of conditions, like regenerating the retina to treat folks who are blind, or other conditions that are listed up here. And so I'm just going to end and tell you that all the data I showed you in the fish came from my lab at Notre Dame. And these are the folks that do the work in my lab. And we're actually funded through several agencies that I've listed here. And thank you so much for your attention.